People have always tended to think that living creatures are unchanging, that the species we see today have existed from the very beginning and were created perfect. During the 19th century, European researchers accumulated findings that refuted this narrative. For instance, they discovered fossils, ancient species or their traces preserved in rock, some familiar and others completely different from the creatures of our time. Evidence such as this led to a conclusion: living species change over time. This process is called evolution. Following this, a question arose: how do living species change? In the 1830s, while on a research expedition, Charles Darwin suggested a possible solution for this mystery. Darwin was well acquainted with the methods of domestication of animals and plants, through which their characteristics are altered for the benefit of humans. The principle is simple. Suppose a gardener wants to domesticate a plant. He chooses a wild species, collects its seeds, and sows them. The plants that sprout and grow from these seeds are very similar to the original plant, but some of them, randomly, have slightly different properties. Some are beneficial to humans, such as large, sweet leaves, and some are undesirable, such as sensitivity to pests. The gardener allows only the most successful plants to reproduce. The new plants inherit traits of their parents, so the next generation is relatively successful compared to the previous one. But these plants have slight variations as well. Again, the desired plants are selected, and this process is repeated. In each generation, the changes are minute, but over time they accumulate and become significant, creating a new variety of the plant. Broccoli, kohlrabi, cabbage, cauliflower, and more all originated from one plant, wild cabbage, which was domesticated by prioritizing different properties. The various breeds of dogs, cats, and horses did not exist in nature either, and are products of selective breeding. This process, which causes a controlled change in the characteristics of a population, is called artificial selection. Darwin proposed that a similar process occurs in nature, but instead of humans selecting the traits that will be inherited, nature itself does so. This is natural selection. About 20 years after his expedition, Darwin published his conclusions in a joint paper with the naturalist Alfred Russel Wallace, who came to the same conclusion independently. Their ideas were not immediately accepted, but as research progressed and new evidence surfaced, the theory became established. To understand how the mechanism of evolution through natural selection works, we shall use an example. Suppose somewhere on a secluded island lives a population of animals that feed on tree leaves. The years go by and the population grows. The lower hanging leaves become a scarce resource. One of the animals, who for random genetic reasons is slightly shorter than the others, has trouble reaching leaves. Therefore, it is likely that it will remain hungry and weak, and die before producing offspring. Another individual, who happens to be tall, reaches the highest leaves, is well fed, and grows healthy and strong. It easily finds a mate and produces offspring. They inherit the genetic traits of their parents and will also tend to be tall. But as a result of the combination of the parents' genes and random genetic mutations, the offspring differ from each other in their characteristics, and some are adapted to their environment even more than their parents. Generation after generation, the taller animals tend to survive and reproduce, while the shorter ones dwindle. Thus, in a slow and gradual process, which may stretch over millions of years, the population on the island changes completely. This is natural selection. Traits that are better adapted to the environment and increase the ability to produce offspring become common in populations. Evidence of these gradual changes is visible all around us. Some of them even take place over the course of a few months or years, and thus we can witness them with our own eyes. A famous example is the peppered moth in England. During the Industrial Revolution, when trees became black from pollution, The darker moths were more camouflaged and thus survived and produced more offspring. This is why the species gradually changed its color from white to black. When the air quality in England improved, the trees turned white again, and with them, the moths. Similar processes occur at the microscopic level. Bacteria and viruses, whose reproduction rate is fast, experience relatively rapid evolution. For example, as a result of the use of antibiotics, selection pressure was exerted on bacteria, and many of them developed resistance to it. Processes that completely change populations are much slower and may occur over vast timescales that dwarf human history. Nevertheless, findings in a variety of fields can shed light on the distant past. Let's take whales for example. Although whales look like big fish, they're actually mammals. In the whale skeleton, there are finger bones inside the fins, and even small bones at the back that are similar to hip bones. These are not typical of an aquatic creature, and it seems that some of them are not necessary at all. Evolution through natural selection provides an explanation for these phenomena. It can be speculated that the whale originated from an ancient species of land mammal with four legs that gradually adapted to life in water due to selection pressure. How can we support this hypothesis? Over millions of years, various ancient cetaceans have been preserved as fossils. Using various chemical and geological dating methods, it is possible to determine their age with good approximation. And so, actual stages in the evolutionary process are revealed to us. We can see that over time, an advantage for individuals with wide feet, which are better suited for swimming, turned the front limbs of the land mammals into fins, while the hind legs, which weighed on the creatures with the development of the tail, became smaller and atrophied. So the process of evolution, which works gradually and without forward planning, may leave behind unnecessary remnants. Traces of the evolutionary process can be found in the human body as well. For instance, we have muscles that attempt to point our ears toward the source of sounds. Many animals use this detection system, but in humans it is merely a relic from the distant past that gradually deteriorated with the development of alternative means of detection. Looking at the rich history of life teaches us that the species around us are not finished products, but merely a snapshot in the midst of constant change in populations. So far, we have seen how a population changes over time, but the theory also helps us understand the existence of different species. Let's go back to the island. Suppose that before the population evolved to be tall, a small group migrated to the other side of the island and found a forest abundant with food. But there were also predators in the forest, and only the small and agile creatures managed to elude their jaws. Over generations, the creatures became smaller, their hearing sharpened, and they adopted new patterns of behavior. The different environmental pressures on either side of the island led to very different developments. After millions of years of evolution, the animals on both sides look completely different, and productive breeding between them is no longer possible. In other words, they are two separate species that share a common ancestor. Splits such as this and other types are what led to the great variety of species today. With the help of research methods such as anatomical comparison, the study of DNA and protein sequences, and fossil analysis, it is possible to learn about the historical ties between living creatures. For example, the various species of whales and dolphins today have a common ancestor that lived about 35 million years ago, which in turn evolved from land creatures. Horses, donkeys, and zebras, who split only about 4 million years ago, can even produce offspring with each other, but they are usually sterile. It is known that in the past few million years, the human population also split into many species or subspecies, which differed in their characteristics and external appearance. Evidence of this are the countless fossils found around the world. Only our species survived thus far, while the others have become extinct. A further look into the past shows that humans, chimpanzees, and bonobos share a common ancestor who lived approximately 6 million years ago. This is expressed, among other things, by a genetic similarity of more than 98%. The division into various classes, such as reptiles, birds, and mammals, stems from the existence of a common ancestor for each of them, who passed down its characteristics. These ancestors also share a common origin. This is why, for example, the limb bones of reptiles, birds, and mammals have an almost identical structure. We can trace it back to ancient species through fossils. The way embryos develop also demonstrates evolutionary history. Embryos of the different vertebrate species initially look almost identical. Human embryos have a tail. We can continue going back in time, through countless splits, until we reach the universal common ancestor of all life on Earth, who lived approximately 4.5 billion years ago. How this ancestor came to be, and what exactly it looked like, cannot be known for sure. But it most likely originated from a very simple life form that assembled randomly in the primordial soup of the young Earth. This form of life was characterized by a simple feature, duplication with random changes. Over billions of years of evolution through natural selection, life has become more and more complex and diverse. In fact, every living thing on Earth is part of one huge family tree, the tree of life, which continues to grow and develop. The theory of evolution is an incredibly elegant answer to the question, how can a blind mechanism create complex systems? It has received countless confirmations from various research avenues and is universally recognized by the scientific community. Nevertheless, in the general public, there is still a false notion that this is a baseless hypothesis. It is important to emphasize that the meaning of the word theory in a scientific context is different from its everyday use. This is not guesswork, but a model that portrays the cutting edge of human knowledge on the subject. Evolution through natural selection is currently at the center of life science research. This knowledge is essential for understanding biological systems, enables countering diseases and pests, contributes to preservation efforts of species and ecosystems, and more. Like any other scientific theory, the theory of evolution continues to develop with the arrival of new evidence. New species are discovered, ancient ancestry is revealed, and a broader picture of the tree of life is unfolding before our eyes.